Family Court 325, our first candidate, Judith Wells. Judith, I'm going to let you take the podium, and I'm going to step off. Our first question is, in 1 minute, tell us about yourself.
Good morning, I'm Judith Wells, and thanks to all of you and your previous support. It's been my honor and my privilege to serve as your 325th Family District Judge. As you may recall, I attended Baylor University and Baylor University Law School, and after graduating law school, I served as Assistant City Prosecutor for the City of Fort Worth. Followed that with 10 plus years of practice in family law in Tarrant County until I was appointed as the Associate Judge of the 325th Family District Court. And I served in that position for 3 years until I was elected as the District Judge. I'm married to my husband of 27 years, Gary Edwards, and we've made Arlington our home for that time period. I'm running for this position so that I can I'm running for this position because I love my job and because I have held this position for 23 years and provided this community a professional court. Thank you.
Our second candidate is Cynthia Terry. Thank you so much. Your first question, in 1 minute, tell us about yourself.
I'll let you know, my name is Cynthia Terry. I'm a mother of three. I've been practicing law for over 10 years, with most of that experience being in family law. I also have criminal and civil experience, both of which touch the family court on a daily basis. I previously had the opportunity early in my career to serve as a judicial magistrate in another state, and so I also have experience on the bench signing warrants and conducting small misdemeanor trials. I was born and raised in a conservative Republican home with parents who've been married 43 years now. They live here in Arlington for the last 20-something years. And in that upbringing, I was raised to have a servant mentality, raised in parochial schools, raised in our church with a strong-knit extended family. And so that gave me a servant heart, has given me a servant heart my entire life. And I want to bring that heart to serve Tarrant County. Thank you.
Moving on to question number two. How would you approach a custody case that involves spousal abuse?
Well, you have to just listen to all of the facts. You have to understand that the family code has provisions in it that state that if there is a family violence, that you have to monitor what you're going to do with the provisions for the visitation. You have to consider strongly whether or not you'll do a joint managing conservatorship. There is a preference if there's family violence that be a sole managing conservatorship versus a joint managing conservatorship. And you have to listen to the evidence carefully to make sure that the family violence has occurred and it's at the level that triggers all of these provisions.
Your second question, how would you approach a custody case that involves spousal abuse?
Every case needs to be approached on an individual basis. I would pray that the abused spouse's attorney is schooled enough and educated enough and experienced enough to bring that evidence properly before the court. It is extremely important to have admissible evidence and to bring, those are some serious issues. And I would take a hard look at that. And if I saw something I just didn't feel was right, I would hope that the proper evidence would be brought before the court. Sometimes the judge can make additional inquiries from the bench. I would use whatever instincts I have to employ in a situation like that and protect the abused spouse.
Question number three, what types of cases have been or will be the hardest for you to adjudicate and why?
The hardest cases for me are the cases involving young babies. And the reason for that is babies need both their parents to bond. They need that time that parents give their babies. If you've had a baby, you know all the time that goes into it. And both parents do that in the hours that are put into that. And when parents are not together as a young baby, it divides that time up. And it is hard, especially when people are not getting along, to assign the time so that the baby gets enough bonding time with each parent, and especially in a meaningful way. And those are always very hard cases for me. And I especially find it very disturbing when, before they get to the court, that they tend to sometimes treat these children as if they do not have feelings and emotions that need to be addressed. Unfortunately, that happens, but lots of times we just have to bring the parents back into focus and get them to focus back on their babies.
Question number three, what types of cases have been or will be the hardest for you to adjudicate and why?
Honestly, I think all family court cases are difficult because you're dealing with someone's life. You're dealing with a family, a husband or a wife, their marriage. You're dealing with the children and the ramifications it has on everyone around them. One case I will tell you about is a case where it was not when I was practicing family law. It was actually when I was a judicial advisory assistant for a state court judge. And in that role, I wrote civil opinions on motions for summary judgment when a party wanted a case kicked out of court. One case was very difficult. A mother was pregnant, so she and her child were killed in a car accident. And so there was a lawsuit that came of that. And the defendants wanted to kick the lawsuit out, saying they couldn't sue for the death of the unborn child. And so I looked really hard at the attorney's briefs. To me, they weren't enough, and so I did my own research and looked at the statute, looked at the legislative intent behind the statute, and made it my one job that week. That was my one case. I told the judge, I was like, please give me extra time for this case. And we ended up being able to save that cause of action to give that family their day in court. And I had the attorneys actually on both sides come in and ask me for that written opinion, so I was very proud of that difficult and challenging decision.
Question number four, what are your thoughts on parenting plans for children with special needs?
Well, those are always crafted on a case-by-case basis. Every special needs child needs something different, and you have different abilities of the parents, you have different job requirements for the parents and time, and so you have to spend time crafting a visitation plan and a treatment plan that takes into account the treatment plan for the child and which parent has the best plans for the child and best able to carry out those plans. So I spend a lot of time crafting specialized visitation provisions for those cases, as well as any additional orders that are needed to address the needs of that child.
Question number four, what are your thoughts on parenting plans for children with special needs?
Parenting plans are important for all children, but particularly for children with special needs. I have a cousin with special needs who's about my age, who's born with Down syndrome, and so I know firsthand what it's like for a child to have special needs. And I think it's extremely important that we keep not only what the mother and father want for themselves as being a parent, but we keep the child's best interests at heart. And so I think it's absolutely necessary for a child with special needs to have a parenting plan tailored to suit that individual child's needs, not just a blanket plan for any child with any certain disability, but a child with that particular child with that particular disability. And I've recently settled a case on an issue like this with my client has an adult child with Down syndrome and a bunch of other health problems. And she has been in court so many times, and finally when she came to me, she just wanted to put this issue to rest. And we were able to do that probably, I want to say, in about definitely less than a year. I want to say it was less than 6 months that we were able to come to a plan that was best for her child and that she's happy with.
Question number five, what are the three most important attributes you should look for when hiring an associate judge and why?
I would look for experience, and I would look for experience not only in family law, but in the law in general, and conservative values. I would want my associate judge to have conservative values, and I would want my associate judge to be very knowledgeable in the law.
Question number five, what are the three most important attributes you should look for when hiring an associate judge and why?
I like this question because when I was a judicial advisory assistant, the first thing I was taught was to avoid the appearance of impropriety all through the court. And in my role, in the secretary's role, and the judge's role, that was the first thing to do. And in order to do that, you were taught to treat everyone the same, whether you know them or not, whether you like them or not, whether they are a pro se party or whether they have an attorney. And so, personally, I would appoint an associate judge who would run the court with transparency, integrity, efficiency, and accountability, which is the way I plan to run the district court. I would look for qualities in an associate judge that could promise that they could do that, and I would look at their track record in doing that as well.
Your sixth and final question, and as why should we vote for you over your opponent?
I have devoted my career in family law to helping families with children. I have the knowledge, I have the experience, and I have the temperament to run this court, and I have done so for the last 23 years. I've worked hard to educate myself on the issues of child abuse and neglect and the effects of divorce on children. We have issues facing the family law courts, not the least of which is the number of new cases that are filed in our court every month. And our courts, each court gets a 400 new cases per month. And we need a judge that is experienced who can come in and effectively and efficiently run this court and get these cases moving. I also need a conservative judge who cares about the rights of others, but especially the children. I am that type of judge, and I have been since taking the bench. And I will promise to you that I will continue to work hard for you and to do right every day. And I ask for your support on March 6th.
Thank you, Candidate Wells. We really appreciate it. A round of applause. Thank you. And your sixth and final question, why should we vote for you over your opponent?
Thank you for asking that. Since it's my final question, I just want to say thanks for having me here. In addition to my professional and conservative qualifications, which I would love for you to approach me about so I could talk more about that, I also have a unique life experience that I'll bring to this bench. As I mentioned, I'm a mother of three, and most of the time you don't plan on doing that alone for the most part, but life happens. And so I understand the fear that these families have in coming into family court. I understand the fear of making those life decisions, how difficult it is, and I understand the difficulties and challenges, ups and downs of co-parenting. Had to do it. And so I will bring that understanding, and my litigants will come before me knowing that they have a judge who understands that and can also still apply the law to the facts of their case. Part of that is also being able to avoid the appearance of impropriety. And I will just say quickly that when I was a law clerk, my then husband practiced in the court before me. I wouldn't even take his phone calls from his office. It would be transferred to someone else. I wouldn't even touch the files or discuss his case with the clerk or anything like that because I wanted to avoid the appearance of impropriety. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Give a round of applause for Candidate Terry.